The lights are on. That means it's time to worship. Hey, Harvest, are you ready to worship? Who's ready to worship? Yes. Man, you guys are ready. And you know it's going to be a great time of worship because, look, we have our choir here. Look at that. Yes. I can't wait, man. Man, what an opportunity, man, to come into God's house with God's people who are like-minded, on one mind, one accord, worshiping the same God together. That's amazing, all right? Let's never take that for granted, guys, all right? It's an honor and a privilege. And for us, it's an honor and a privilege to serve you as well. So we're so glad to do that this morning. My name is Ramirez Moody. I serve as the Associate Campus Pastor here at our Rolling Meadows Campus. And welcome to our service. And if this is your first time joining us, I know it can seem scary, but don't be scared. You're amongst the welcoming people, and I'm one of them. So I'm going to be in the lobby after service. I would love to meet you. Just stop by the bright white welcome sign. I'll be there, okay? I won't take up too much of your time. Harvest, do you know that we want to help you to grow in your relationship with the Lord? And the best way that we've come up to do that is through our Harvest Bible Chapel app. If you pull out your phones right now and log on to the app, you'll see that there's a connect card, and you can do just that. You can connect into community here at Harvest through our various growth groups. But if you are like Candace Donnelly, who's already checked in, then this might not apply to you. But if you have not checked in yet, do that while you're there, okay? We not only want to know that you're here today, but we also would like to know how we can be praying for you this week. Our staff counts it a great joy to pray for the people in our church. Ladies, just really quick announcement. Women's Conference, Women on Mission is next week, all right? There's still room to register. Next week, June 3rd, is going to be at our Elgin campus between 9 a.m. and 9 p.m. Don't miss the opportunity to fellowship with other women here in our church and get to know other women, but also get encouraged through God's word as well. Man, we are right in the middle of a very special season. Anyone know what? No, I won't have you guess. I'll just tell you. It's graduation season. And so whether you've graduated from kindergarten or eighth grade or high school or college, just know that we are thinking about you and we are praying for you. Okay, in fact, we're going to pray for you this morning. And speaking of praying, we want to pray for our like-minded churches in our area. And today we're highlighting Mission Church in Bloomingdale and their pastor, John Peacock. Will you join me as we pray for their church? God, we thank you for Mission Baptist Church, and we thank you for everything that you're doing in their ministry. God, will you just continue to provide all the needs of their church as they clearly proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ unapologetically. Lord, will you bless them, encourage their congregation. May they not grow weary in doing well. And God, we are so grateful for our graduates and everything that you have already done in their lives so far. But God, we're thanking you and praising you for everything that you are still yet to do. It is our prayer that they will have a major impact for your kingdom in the years to come. And God, we thank you for today's service, and we thank you for the opportunity that we get to come together and worship your Son, and worship you, and worship and be in your presence, God. We thank you. And so, God, as we stand to our feet and give you our praise, may it be pleasing to your ears and precious in your sight. Lord, we thank you, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Harvest, let's stand to our feet and worship with our choir. Let's go.
Well, good morning, everybody. It's good to see y'all today, and it's good to be together to worship. And we're going to start this morning with a prayer that we're going to pray together to center ourselves on the Lord as we come to him and remember his kindness and mercy that's new to us even now. And so would you just follow along as we pray. Meet us, O Christ, in the stillness of the morning. Move us, O Spirit, to quiet our hearts. Mend us, O Father, from yesterday's harms. From the discords of yesterday, resurrect our peace. From the discouragement of yesterday, resurrect our hope. From the weariness of yesterday, resurrect our strength. From the doubts of yesterday, resurrect our faith. From the wounds of yesterday, resurrect our love. As we worship you anew this day, make us aware of our need and awaken us to your grace. Let today be about you, O Lord. God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's start by singing this chorus.
And I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about sing, I'm coming back. And I'm coming back to the heart of worship. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. And I have been saved by the grace of God, amen. I have been raised to a future without end. I set my eyes on a true and loyal friend, the one whose life I'm hidden in.
Let's sing his name, Jesus.
Jesus, and all my hope in Jesus, the for my joy. gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
Come on.
You're never gonna let, you're never gonna, oh thank you Lord that I know. You're never gonna let, you are always faithful. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. I'll sing it, oh. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You are good, you're good, oh, you are good, you're good, oh, you are good,
yes you are,
yes you are, oh, you are good, you're good, oh, you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. In Jesus, Lord, that you are good, yes, and oh, you are good, you're good, Lord.
Come on.
There was a moment when the lights went out, when death had claimed its victory. The King of love had given up his life, the darkest day in history. There on a cross they made for sinners, for every curse his blood atoned. One final breath and it was finished. Not the end we could have known.
Listen.
Before the earth began to shake and the veil was torn, what sacrifice was made as the heavens roll. Oh, little King Jesus,
Jesus,
and all will say,
Great to worship. God, we love you. God, we love you. So good to worship you. We're going to worship now through our giving, which is something that we do every time we gather. We sing, we worship in spirit and in truth. And so we come together and we sing of the faithfulness of God, of the goodness of God, of the grace of God, of the work of Christ that has been spoken over our lives because we are now in Christ. And it's not just our words, though, that we come with, but we also come with all of our lives and organize our whole lives around the way of Jesus and around the priorities of the kingdom. And giving is a way that we do that. But giving always starts with a heart of worship. And it's something we talk about a lot, but it's something that I want to continue to just communicate, that giving always starts with a heart of worship. 1 Chronicles 29, there's this great passage. The people have all gathered gifts, and Solomon is dedicating the temple, and he's up in front of the people, and he prays this beautiful prayer. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. Do you see the ascription of worth to the living God as the starting place of the dedication of these gifts? For all that is in the heavens and the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and in your hand is to make great and to give strength to all. And now we thank you, Lord, our God, and praise your glorious name. So there are ways to give that are on the screen right now. You can give through the app that Ramirez had mentioned earlier, online, or through the mail, or through text. But even if you gave during the week, we still want to take the time as we're the gathered church right now and dedicate our gifts as an act of worship. So would you pray with me as we do that? Yours is the glory and the kingdom and the honor, Jesus. You are the one who's found worthy. Who's found worthy to take the scroll from the right hand of the Father, as Revelation 5 says, which is really like you're the one who can carry out justice and make things right in our world. And we praise you and we thank you for that. Lord, we are created in order to glorify and worship you. And so in every aspect of our lives, Lord, we come with our song, we come with the posture of our hearts. We come with our material things and our offerings. Lord, we come with the way that we relate to one another. Would you shape us and form us through all these different things that we do, acts of worship, and the type of people that you had in mind for us to be from the beginning. God, we love you and we praise you. Would you receive these gifts now as we give them from a heart of worship and a heart of love, and continue to just express our love to you. We pray this in Jesus' name, and all God's people say,
my freedom. Death and its curse have no claim. Our God is forever exalted, with glory and honor and praise. Sing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. For the Lord our God, no mighty reigns. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. For the Lord our God, no mighty reigns. Hallelujah, amen. For the Lord our God, no mighty reigns. Yes, the Lord our God, no mighty reigns. For the Lord our God, no mighty reigns. Hallelujah, amen.
So Lord, would you receive our worship today? And now as we come to your word, would you shape and form us by your spirit? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Would you guys grab a seat this morning?
Morning. My name is Mike Van Lanningham. I was on staff here. I'm retired now, but I recently went on the elder board, which is really exciting. What a great group of guys. You have no idea what a privilege it is. So we are in the midst of Memorial Day weekend, right? And so we want to recognize those who have served in our military forces. And if you're a vet, would you please, or if you're a vet, or if a loved one of yours is or was a vet, would you please stand up so we can recognize you, please? Thank you for your service, and if you have loved ones who gave it all, you have our profoundest gratitude and sympathy. I want to welcome all the other campuses this morning. I'm told I have to say that, so there it's said. You know, there's other people, I guess, watching. If you would take your Bibles, turn to the book of Jonah. We're going to be continuing our study in the book. I am told by experts who have looked into it that about 60% of the Old Testament is what Bible teachers call narrative. We might think of it as history, same thing. It's the stories in the Bible, they're true stories, okay? And so about 60% of the Old Testament is narrative. Jonah, while it's in the minor prophets and it's considered one of the prophets, nevertheless, it's stuffed full of narrative. One of the things that these experts will tell us is that when you come to Old Testament narratives, it's okay to look at the human characters in a narrative as getting lessons from them and seeing some important things. But the key is always to understand that in a typical narrative, it's God who's the hero of the narrative. And so as you read through the Old Testament stories, pay attention to the human characters, but see what they say about God and how they emphasize his role in human affairs. What we're going to do is we're going to be looking at Jonah chapter 1, verses 4, all the way through chapter 2 and verse 10. And we're going to start initially here by actually reading Jonah chapter 1, verses 1, 2, and 3. So Jeff Bucknam, you know, could preach 50 minutes on three verses. So we're going to be here about 9 hours this morning. I just want you to know that. So Jonah chapter 1, verse 1 says, "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, 'Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me.' But Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. So he paid the fare and went down into it." Notice he goes down into the hold of the ship, because that comes up in a little bit. "To go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord." What we're going to see in our lesson this morning, in the passages that we're going to be looking at, is that it is always a good idea to do what our sovereign and loving God has commanded us to do. And there are two reasons why it's a really good idea. The first reason, in chapter 1, verses 4 through 16, is that if we don't do what he commands us, he might send a storm, which he will control. We do have to say that. Notice here, as we're emphasizing God's sovereignty and his kindness in this passage, in verses 4 and 5, it says that he crafted the tempest. It says in verse 4, "But the Lord hurled a great wind upon the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship threatened to break up." We don't know exactly very much about this ship. It was probably a Phoenician ship. Phoenicia was the area north of Israel, what we would think of as modern Lebanon and western Syria. And so they were sort of the seagoing people of that day. If you wanted to go somewhere by boat, you found a Phoenician ship and they would take you. It was probably between 50 and 70 feet long, probably a couple of masts with sails, but you could also row it. When they would come in, they would dock at a dock, and they would have to row it into place rather than trust the wind to get them there all safely and everything. But this ship is in the midst of a serious storm, and it's beginning to break up. And it says in verse 5, "Then the mariners were afraid." Now, we're talking about veteran sailors here. When a veteran sailor is in a storm and he's afraid, then that's a big deal. And so it's quite a threat. I want you to imagine them out there, and probably in a crew like this, we're talking maybe 5 to 7 guys. This is a cargo ship, right? And so they're there, and they're on deck, and they're tending to the ship. And the wind is howling, and the sea has white caps plus on it, and they're getting water blown into their face, and they're soaked to the bone, and they're trying to talk to one another, and the wind takes away their voice, and the water's flowing down off of their hair onto their face, and it's really serious. I want you to think just for a second of Gilligan's Island. "The weather started getting rough. The tiny ship was tossed. If not for the courage of the fearless crew, the minnow would be lost. The minnow would be lost." You guys have no idea what I'm talking about, do you? No idea whatsoever. Gilligan's Island is the pinnacle of American culture. So it was pretty bad. And it says in verse 5, "Each cried out to his god." Now, the Phoenicians had a pantheon of gods, and they worship all kinds of gods. They had different gods at different locales. different locales would have their own gods. There were some major gods sort of overseeing the entire pantheon. But so these guys are probably from different parts of Phoenicia. They have their own gods, and they're crying out to all of them. The Phoenician gods, by and large, were localized from the standpoint that some would be in charge of the rain. Some would be in charge. Some of the gods would be in charge of crops. Some of the gods would be in charge of business on the ocean and all kinds of other things like that. And so they're just crying out to all of their gods because they want to get rescued. They began to throw off the cargo to lighten the ship. The ship was taking on water. It says in verse 5 that Jonah had gone down into the inner part of the ship and had lain down and was fast asleep. Now, it's possible, some people maintain this, that what we see here is Jonah so trusting God that he's completely at peace with the surroundings, has no issues. God's going to take care of him. And I'm thinking, did you read the first three verses of Jonah 1? He ain't trusting God. He wants nothing to do with God because God wants him to go to Nineveh, Nineveh, the ancient foe of Israel, and preach to them. When I was younger, like especially in college this happened, sometimes I'd get massively stressed or depressed or something. I would use sleep as a defense mechanism, as an escape mechanism. And I'm going to suggest that Jonah was probably pretty stressed from having known God's will for him and resisted it. And so he goes down and he is out. He is out. This is the same word for sleep that's used in Genesis chapter 2 and verse 21 for the deep sleep that God put Adam in when God created Eve from Adam's side. So he's in this sort of stupor, is Jonah. So God not only crafted the tempest, but he also governed the crew. Verses 6 to 13. So the captain came and said to him, "What do you mean, you sleeper? Arise, call out to your God. Perhaps the God will give a thought to us that we may not perish." Now, they don't know who Jonah is. They don't know where he's from. They don't know who his God is. But there's nothing to be lost by having one other person pray out to their God, whoever that is. And so he makes Jonah get up and has to do that. And it says in verse 7, they said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots, that we may know on whose account this evil has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Now, we don't know exactly what casting lots, how they did that back then. It's been suggested, and this seems reasonable to me, that they might have taken little pieces of wood or stones and written the names of the people on the ship on these stones, put them in a bag, shake them up, dump the bag out, whichever stone hit first or hit last, or maybe they would take the bag and have the stones go out this way, whichever one ended up farthest away or nearest away, they would see that as the gods indicating which one is the answer to the inquiry that they're making by casting the lots. We don't know exactly what's going on. But this is something that they're doing to try to figure it out. And sure enough, Jonah is the one indicated by their casting of lots. Notice God's sovereignty again here. God's sovereign by bringing the storm. God's sovereign by having the lot indicate Jonah. Verse 8, then they said to him, "Tell us on whose account this evil has come upon us." So in other words, they just found it out by casting the lots. They know that it's Jonah, but they want confirmation. They don't want to get this wrong. They want to make sure that Jonah is actually the one. Notice the questions they ask. "What's your occupation? Where do you come from? What's your country? What people are you?" You know, why are we having a little interview time here? Well, they're trying to figure out who Jonah is, where he's from, and who his gods are, so that maybe they can determine which of his gods, potentially, he has offended and ticked off so that the storm has come upon them now. So they're asking him all kinds of questions. We do the same thing. Sometimes we ask people questions and we can determine all kinds of stuff about them. You know, if you run into somebody from Rome, in terms of their religion, they're probably Roman Catholic. If you run into somebody from Saudi Arabia, they're probably Muslim. If you encounter somebody from Salt Lake City, they're probably Mormon. If you run into somebody from California, they're probably nothing at all in California. I used to live there, so I can say that. He said to them in verse 9, I'm a Hebrew. And then here comes a really ironic statement. I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. Well, the ironic thing is that he does not actually fear God. As we're going to see, actually, in the first two chapters of Jonah, the only people who fear God are the Phoenician sailors. Isn't that ironic? But notice he says, I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land. We're not talking about some limited, localized Phoenician God now. Jonah says, my God lives in heaven, has created all the land and all the sea, which is seething right now. And then it says, in verse 10, the men were exceedingly afraid. And the idea is, you think about it for a second, now they've just found out that Jonah's God, who Jonah has upset, is the one who made all of this. He's massively powerful. And so now, whereas they were afraid before, now they are even more afraid because this is an incredible God who is mad. It says in verse 10, what is this that you have done? That is, Jonah, what have you done to infuriate your God? The men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he had told them, which I just think is really weird. You know, if I'm going to run away from God and be disobedient to him, I'm hardly going to broadcast it to anybody. On the other hand, what's Jonah going to do? The ship's about to sink. They're desperate. They're looking at him, you know, tell us what's going on. And so he had to tell them. Then they said to him, verse 11, what shall we do to you that the sea may quiet down for us? For the sea grew more and more tempestuous, so the storm just got ratcheted up. So they're now doing research. Jonah, we don't know you. We don't know who your God is. We don't know what it would take to make him happy. So we're asking you. You know your own God. You tell us what to do so that we can actually be alleviated of all of this threat to us. And what does he say in verse 12? He said to them, pick me up, hurl me into the sea, and then the sea will quiet down for you, for I know it is because of me that this great tempest has come upon you. Now, there are some scholars who look at this passage and say, oh, isn't Jonah just being wonderfully Christ-like here? He's being so self-sacrificial, so noble. But again, I want to propose that if you read the first part of Jonah, and if you read through Jonah chapter 4, you get rather a different picture. He's more like a petulant sixth grader than he is Jesus. And I want you to turn over just a second to Jonah chapter 4, verses 2 and 3. I'm going to suggest that what he is proposing here is that he would rather die than be rescued and go to Nineveh. In Jonah chapter 4, verses 2 and 3, it says, and he, that is Jonah, in the wake of having preached to Nineveh and Nineveh repented, and God then waylaid any of the judgment. So Jonah prayed to the Lord and said, oh Lord, is this not what I said when I was in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you're a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, relenting from disaster. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it's better for me to die than to live. He didn't want to see the Ninevites get saved. So what I'm going to suggest here is when he says this, he's just saying, you know what, guys? I don't care. Just throw me overboard. I don't want to go on anymore. I don't want to be rescued. I wonder if Jonah would have repented. I'm going to guess the storm would have stopped right then and there. But he doesn't. So he has a death wish. He would rather die. Notice he also says, if you throw me overboard, the sea will quiet down. Now, he does have enough kindness to think, you know what? No reason for these innocent sailors to die. Just let me croak, and it'll all be good. And here, Jonah actually, for the first time, functions as a prophet. He tells the future, the sea will calm down, you throw me overboard. And it does. It says in verse 13, nevertheless, men rowed hard to get back to dry land, but they could not, for the sea grew more and more tempestuous against them. Now, somehow, these guys are thinking, no, we don't really know. Even if we throw Jonah overboard, is that the right thing? Is Jonah shooting it straight with us? How do we know that this is going to fix the situation? Plus, he paid money to be able to go on this. They're actually sort of contractually obligated to get him to Tarshish. And then God comes along, and what does he do? He calms the sea. Verses 14 to 16. Therefore, they called out to the Lord. The sailors did. O Lord, let us not perish for this man's life, and lay not on us innocent blood. That is, God, if we throw Jonah overboard, please don't make it worse for us. Don't judge us. And then they say, for you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. In other words, here's what they're saying. Lord, you brought this storm along. You're making this happen. If we throw Jonah overboard to save our skin, don't blame us. God, this is your fault for all of this happening. Great argument, isn't it? Let's blame God. But that's exactly what they do. So, Lord, don't blame us. So they picked up Jonah, verse 15, and hurled him into the sea. And sure enough, the sea ceased from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. So these Phoenician sailors, were they converted here? Did they get saved? Hard to say for sure, but I kind of expect to see these guys in heaven someday. Isn't that fun to think about? You know, it says they feared the Lord exceedingly. Same word that's used in the rest of the Old Testament for how important it is for the people of God to fear God. It says they offered a sacrifice and made vows. In chapter 2 and verse 9, it's going to say the same thing about Jonah. I kind of think maybe here, they had enough knowledge of the true God that they trusted in him. Something else God did is that he placed the great fish here in verse 17. And the Lord appointed a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Now, it's cool. I had a chance this week to study marine biology. There's all kinds of different whales out there. Do you guys know that? Different whales. Most all whales don't have a big enough digestive tract to accommodate a man. Their throats are like about this big around, really small, and they don't stretch all that well. And so people look at this and go, ah, see, the critical scholars who don't actually believe the Bible, say, this is a myth, this is a legend, this is just a story, this is a fabrication, whales can't do this. First of all, it says a great fish swallowed him. Some of you are thinking, well, a fish is not a whale. So this is a fish, you've got swallowed by a whale, then we have an error in Scripture. No, 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 no. The Hebrews didn't distinguish between air-breathing sea creatures and those with gills. They didn't distinguish. If it was a big animal in the water, they called it, by the Hebrew word here, dog. Believe it or not, that's what they called it. It was a dog. And that's what scoops up Jonah, is this big sea creature, probably a whale. There is, however, one whale that does have the anatomy and physiology big enough to accommodate a man. The sort of the technical name for this whale is Physister macrocephalus, which being translated is whale with a really big head. That's what it is, okay? The more popular name of this whale is the sperm whale, which is awkward to say, and so we'll call it the big-headed whale from here on out in our message. Now, the big-headed whale has a mouth big enough where, I'm told, 15 people can stand in it. And they have such a big digestive tract. When whales were being harvested and they would harvest the big-headed whale, they could find dolphins and sharks and seals in the intestinal tract, the stomach and digestive tract of these whales could absolutely accommodate a man. And so the people who just dismiss this as a complete myth, they don't really understand what's going on here. Now, we could say more and more and more about all of the whale stuff, but we're not going to, because as G. Campbell Morgan once said, a British evangelist and pastor who died in 1945, he said, people have been looking so hard at the great fish that they have failed to see the great God. So God appointed this fish. By the way, the big-headed whales are in the Mediterranean Sea. They've been spotted all the time. They're seen with great frequency in and around Israel. And so this can happen. All right, he's in the belly of the whale, of the fish, 3 days and three nights. Jesus uses this imagery in Matthew chapter 12, verse 40. He's interacting with his opponents. He says, we're not going to give you a really spectacular sign, except the sign of Jonah. And I think what he's doing is he's making a parallel between what happened to Jonah and what's going to happen to him. Jonah was in the belly of the whale 3 days and three nights, and then, as it were, sort of, kind of, came back to life. Jesus is going to be in the tomb 3 days and three nights, and then he comes back to life. What a sign that is. Now, somebody's going to say, well, Jesus wasn't, he wasn't in the grave 72 hours. You know, in Hebrew thinking, any part of a day was considered a day and a night. It was just sort of an idiomatic thing that they did. And so if they said a day and a night, they meant any part of a day and the night too. And so Jesus draws on this. All right, so it's always a good idea to do what our sovereign God commands us, and there's two good reasons for it. And the first was, if we don't, he might send a storm, which he'll control. Here's the second reason why it's a good idea to do what he wants us to do. If we don't, we'll have to repent, which probably won't be pleasant. And here we have Jonah's prayer that he recorded later, after he got out of the fish. In verses 1 and 2, we see what Jonah said. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the belly of the fish, saying, I called out to the Lord out of my distress, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. Sheol is typically a Hebrew word that refers to the grave, or maybe what happens, you know, a person when they're dead. We're not talking about a place of disembodied souls. In the Old Testament, Sheol is a place that's dark, nobody talks, there's dirt, there's decay, there's worms, that's the grave, it's not a place of departed souls. All of which is to say that Jonah sees himself, when he's thrown into the water, he sees himself as a dead man. Here's what Jonah suffered in verses 3 through 6. For thou cast me into the deep, he says to God, into the heart of the sea, and the flood surrounded me. All your waves and your billows passed over me. So now he's talking about when he first gets thrown in, he's sort of treading water. He's able to keep his head above water. But that's going to become more and more of a struggle. And notice in verse 3 also of chapter 2, it says, for you cast me into the deep, he says to God. Now I'm thinking to myself, if I've read chapter 1 correctly, he wasn't thrown into the ocean by God. He was thrown in by Phoenician sailors. So what's the deal with that? Well, let me just propose that Jonah was a good Calvinist. And he recognized God's controlling hand, even in the situation. And so he ascribes the ultimate action of what happened to him to God. And the Bible does this so often. God does things to fulfill his sovereign will in Scripture. And he even works through, superintends, providentially governs human actions, free human actions performed by people. And yet, even if they do something sinful, they're not blamed. God is not blamed for the evil that sinful people do, even though he governs it, stands behind it, is sovereign over it. Two examples. Please don't look these up because we don't have time. And notice the stupid little Telecaster thing is not up here, you know. I don't know how to use that. Man, if it's not WordPerfect 5.1 for DOS, forget about it. So, two examples from Scripture where God works his sovereign will through the free actions of people. In the case of Joseph in the Old Testament, Genesis 45, verse 5 and verse 8, it says, "And now do not be distressed or angry," Joseph says to his brothers when they discover that it's him down in Egypt. "Don't be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here. For God sent me before you to preserve life." So which was it? Did the brothers sell Joseph down to Egypt, or did God send him to Egypt? The answer is yes. He goes on, "So it was not you," Joseph says, "who sent me here, but God. God sent me here." And then in chapter 50 and verse 20, it's kind of a famous verse, Joseph says again to his brothers, "As for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, to bring about many people would be kept alive as they are today." So the brothers meant evil. They sinned against Joseph, but God meant something different in overseeing their sinful actions. And of course, the supreme example of this is Jesus. In Acts chapter 4, verse 27 and 28, this is a summarized prayer from the early church in the midst of great persecution. And they prayed, praying to God, "in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you, God, anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel, to do whatever your hand and your plan had predestined to take place." Notice, the people who crucified Jesus were not forced into it. They freely exercised their will. They made their decision based upon what they thought was right and good. No sense of coercion here. And yet what they did freely, God predestined that they would do. And you might go, "I don't know how that works." Let me just say, neither do I. Nor does anybody. There's a thing in the Bible that we better get used to called mystery, and especially as it relates to God, all kinds of mystery. How can the three be one? How can, for example, Scripture be a human production and a divine production? Both. I mean, guys, I'm just here to tell you, the Bible's full of mystery. We better get used to just living with it because it's there. And here's a textbook example of this. Listen, I just want to say, God is providential over Jonah's storm, but he's providential over the storms in our own lives. When we encounter hard things, even if the hard things we encounter have been brought on by our own foolishness and sinfulness, God nevertheless governs the storm in which we find ourselves and promises to bring good out of it. In my own life, there have been four occasions where there were massive redirects in my life. Three of those related to a job loss. One of them related to cancer that I had. And in all four of those situations, there were enormous challenges, and there were big storms. And in every case, God governed it to bring good out of it, especially for my family. I would hope maybe for the people of God as well, but I'll let the people of God and God determine that. But for me and my family, those storms, he brought great things out of them for us. And I'm convinced that God is so sovereign and so loving, he will do the same for you. Now, continuing. Still talking about what Jonah suffered. Verse 4, then I said, I am driven away from your sight. Yet shall I look again upon your holy temple. That is, he hopes to be able to go back to church someday. And he was confident that he would. He figured, you know, if God wanted him dead, this fish wouldn't have swallowed him. The waters closed in over to take my life. So now he's beginning to sink below the surface. The deep surrounded me. Weeds were wrapped around my head at the roots of the mountains. That is, he went down to where, you know, the land went way down into the water. And yet it says at the end of verse 6, yet you brought up my life from the pit, another term for the grave. Here's what Jonah thought, verses 7 to 9. When my life was fainting away, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer came to you, to your holy temple. Those who pay regard to vain idols forsake their hope of steadfast love. The word steadfast love here is a Hebrew term, chesed. Chesed is the covenant love of God for his people. Jonah, as one of the people of God, was experiencing God's powerful love right at this moment. God rescued him from this watery grave. Those who worship idols forfeit any opportunity to have God undertake for them and to help them and to have the power to rescue them. So better not worship idols. Verse 9, but I with the voice of thanksgiving, I'm not going to worship idols, but I will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will pay. Salvation belongs to the Lord. And so notice that Jonah is enormously grateful that God has rescued him from drowning. But then we have again a massively ironic statement. Salvation belongs to the Lord. Yes, but Jonah is very happy that God has rescued him, and he doesn't give a rip about the people in Nineveh, at least 500,000 people. He loves having the salvation of God, doesn't want them to have it. Doesn't that just seem so ironic? James Nogalski, who's an Old Testament professor at Baylor, writes, how does one account for these opposing pictures of a Jonah whose gratitude to God runs deep for his own deliverance, but whose anger at God for extending compassion to foreigners colors all his actions? The church, like the world at large, still has many Jonahs. These persons can speak at great length about gratitude they have for what God has done for them, but they have far less interest in what God has done for others. They can tell of dramatic conversions from a life of sin to a life of fulfillment in Christ, yet they have little compassion for those who remain trapped in similar cycles of destructive behavior or systems that keep them in poverty. It is far easier to find comfort worshiping with those who are like us than to live and work in ways designed to improve the lives of those who will not be found inside the church walls. Salvation is of the Lord. It's right and it's good for us to say, thank you, Jesus, for saving me. But the implication is we need to take that out and tell others, do we not? And so the fact and the degree to which we are reluctant to do so, we're just like Jonah. So what did God do? In verse 10, it says, the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah out upon the dry land. Now, the Hebrew word for vomited here means barfed. That's what it means. That's the technical expression for that word. All right, a couple of points of application. First, let me suggest that we never mistake a change of behavior for a change of heart. Sometimes we do or say things we shouldn't, and we get in trouble for it. On those occasions, we feel bad, not necessarily because we regret the harmful thing or the sinful thing that we did, but rather because we got caught and because a storm has begun to form around us, and we have to face the consequences. When that happens, we change our behavior just to get people off of our back. But what we should really do is to have a change of heart so that we actually despise the sin in us that led us to do the harmful, sinful thing. There's a difference between a change of behavior and a change of heart. Jonah here has a change of behavior. He gets out of the fish. Guess what? Goes the 500 miles to Nineveh from Joppa. Does he want to go? No. Has he had a change of heart? No. Has he changed his behavior? Yeah. But that's not repenting. Robert Stevenson, the pastor of Village Baptist Church in Aurora, also known as my son-in-law, who's a preacher. This is not his message, by the way. But on this he wrote, for all his acknowledgement of his plight and God's salvation in his prayer, Jonah never once confesses his sin. Even more, there is no mention of Jonah's involvement in getting himself into this mess to begin with. He is quick to recognize God's sovereign hand in the whole affair, but never once acknowledges his own hardness of heart. When we compare this to something such as Psalm 51, we begin to hear the difference in attitude. There David declares, Psalm 51, have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity. Cleanse me from my sin. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise. Lord, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me. We have to have heart change in our lives when we see the sin that's there. And I take it that it starts with doing what David did. Ask God to change our heart and a clean heart and having a changed heart means that we have to be sincerely grieved for the sin that's in us and that we do. We have to have sort of a sanctified disgust with how we are sometimes and seek him to change us. In addition, never equate gratitude for deliverance with repentance from sin. You may turn to God when you're in a serious pickle, and you may be really happy if in his kindness he spares you serious consequence, but it doesn't mean that you've turned to him in repentance and that he's now pleased with you. And then lastly, always believe a storm is the prelude for a second chance. Isn't that great? What happens with Jonah? Storm. He gets delivered. God gives him a second chance. He goes to Nineveh, and even though his attitudes are all whacked, they're all messed up, God still does amazing things through him in the wake of having delivered him and rescued him. Guys, he's going to do the same for us. The storms that come along, he stands behind them, and in the wake of them, he's going to use us to do some incredible things. I hope you believe that. We see that with Jonah. We've got to believe that God is there in the storm, right? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this great lesson that we have. We get so fixated on the fish that we forget you. Thank you for your sovereignty. But also, thank you for the love you showed the Phoenicians, for the love that you showed Jonah by rescuing him and giving him another chance to begin to try to do the right things, even though he doesn't have the right attitudes. Father, what a great comfort that is to us to know that you're sovereign and powerful and loving all together at the same time. We are enormously grateful for who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. And all God's people said, amen.
Amen. Let's stand and respond in gratitude for who God is.
Coming back to you.
Amen. We are always His. Man, I really love what Michael said. He said, believe that a storm is the prelude for a second chance. You know, sometimes when we are in a storm, we're just trying to figure it out, right? It's all about us. How do we get out of this? And we lose focus on the mission at hand. And the mission at hand is to go, therefore, and make disciples. It is to live out the Christian life in front of those who don't know Christ. Let's not be like Jonah in that, in taking what God has gifted us and keeping it to ourselves and holding it for ourselves. It's not for just for us, it's for others. And thank God we have an extra off day this week to figure out a way to do just that. Whether it's at a barbecue, the music we played, or maybe it's sidewalk chalk that says Jesus loves you. Whatever it is, we should be all about God's business and sharing the gospel of the good news with others. So let's be how Jonah was after the storm, okay? Let's go and therefore make disciples. Also, too, if you are in a storm and you would like someone to pray for you or pray with you, we will have leaders up front. Don't leave without that happening. And if you're new, I'd like to meet you. I'm going to be in the lobby. And as we go out on mission for Christ this week, let's be Jonah, okay? Let's go and make disciples, all right? You guys ready to do that? All right. You're loved.